Going to cross over to Laguna Beach, California, joined by Alexander Azadgan, professor of international political economy and editor at large of imperialnews.com. Thanks so much for being with us, Alexander. You have seen again, we see that SEPAR, or the IRGC, has responded to another terrorist attack that had taken place. Give me your overall evaluation of this and what type of message that it sends.
Thank you for your invitation, Marzia. It's always good to be with Press TV. First of all, Iran has lost over 17,000 people to terrorist attacks, according to ADVT, Association in Defense of Victims of Terrorism, a UN-recognized NGO. Iran is actually one of the biggest victims of terrorism, which is something many people around the world don't know. Second, Iran has every right to defend itself and its citizens against terrorism. I think this is a logical, but unfortunately, it's not portrayed that way sometimes. And contrary to propaganda against IRGC, IRGC, which is a hybrid, conventional, asymmetric military force, has had a very successful record in fighting terrorism. Case in point would be ISIS in Iraq and in Syria since 2012, at least, al-Nusra in Syria. There's this other terrorist group that was called Jundullah. It was a Saudi-supported Wahhabi terrorist group which used to operate in southeast Iran. And of course, as you mentioned, as of lately, a five-missile strike against the KDPI and PDKI, Kurdish terrorists in northern Iraq, in the city of Koya, which is about 300 kilometers north of Baghdad. So in my opinion, no country would stay silent in the face of terrorism. Immediate, surgical, and resolute response has always been the policy of Iran in facing terrorism. Logically, no country should have a problem with that. But unfortunately, that has not been the case with Washington, which, you know, goes on and calls al-Qaeda the very group that it accuses of the 9/11 attacks and reshapes them into another group that they call al-Nusra or et cetera, all these al-Sham group, al-Sham this, al-Sham that, and then calls these terrorists a Syrian opposition or rebel groups, which they definitely are not. Go ahead.
Well, I want to get into that part a little bit later in our discussion, but I want to look at what does this mean and when we look at as far as Iran's intelligence, that this is not the first time that the IRGC is able to strike a terrorist base outside of the borders of Iran, and also from a technological perspective with the accuracy of their missiles.
Iran's intelligence is impeccable. IRGC's external arm, Al-Quds force, they are impeccable in their response. Iran has the fourth largest cyber army in the world, but they don't solely rely on that. The human intelligence is very praiseworthy. And so the responses are accurate. Iranian intelligence services have this sort of creed that you keep your friends close, but your enemies closer. So that's why you have these immediate responses to many of these terrorist attacks, because Iran has identified where they are, who they are. And when they commit such horrific acts, they need response surgically and right to the point. And this has really baffled many people in the West as far as how Iran is able to respond so resolutely. I also wanted to mention, Marzia, that UN on many occasions has been very praising of Iran's fight against terrorism, in particular in its eastern borders with Afghanistan and Pakistan. They even called for better funding to be provided to Iran to continue its fight against terrorism, but instead we get these baseless and unfounded accusations. And frankly, in my opinion, they are libelous and slanderous against Iran, as was demonstrated, unfortunately, by President Trump at the recent UNGA. So instead of praising Iran to, you know, in doing what it does to defeat the terrorism, they falsely accuse it. And this is quite baffling to people in the West. They cannot put these, you know, two things together and conclude that Iran is, in fact, is a great force against terrorism, both regional and within its borders.
And doesn't that highlight the hypocrisy in general of some Western governments' policy, Alexander? If we look at even U.S. President Donald Trump prior to taking over the highest office there, when he was a candidate, he actually praised Iran in fighting for fighting terrorism inside of Syria, as well as even the Syrian military and Russia. So what has happened in the whole scheme of things? Because, of course, we know that according to Donald Trump now, Iran is enemy number one instead of the terrorists.
That's actually a very excellent question. Just to answer you briefly, Marzia, I think what has happened is that the neocons have hijacked this administration. Mr. Trump certainly has a lot of skeletons in his closet, and I think these people will use that against him to blackmail him even further if he promises or if he acts more accordingly to candidate Trump, which, let's not forget, this is the candidate that looked right into Hillary Clinton's eyes and actually pointed his finger at her and he said, you and Mr. Obama created ISIS and you wasted $6 trillion of American funds. But the neocons have fully taken over that administration. We have people like Mike Pompeo, who replaced a relatively reasonable man, Rex Tillerson, as our Secretary of State. And of course, the worst of them all, I'm afraid to say, John Bolton, who is a super neocon, who was a super neocon in the George W. Bush administration. And until his assignment as our national security advisor, he would lecture in front of terrorist groups like MEK, MKO in Paris, which are known to have murdered over 12,000 Iranians, over 25,000 Iraqis. They were a mercenary force for Saddam Hussein, and they operated over 400 terrorist operations in Iran. So I think what we need to make clear for the American people, our audience, is that this cognitive dissonance that currently exists in the minds of many is, just like you said, is pure hypocrisy, and that Washington is, in fact, the leading state sponsor of terrorism, along with its proxies and its vassal states in the region, particularly UAE, Saudi Arabia, and up until lately, Qatar, which luckily, happily has changed course. But them and along with the certain regime in Eastern Mediterranean, they are supporting terrorists in Syria, and they don't see it. They don't see it to their advantage, unfortunately, to their national interest, unfortunately. They misobserve it, and they don't, you know, it's not, they don't try to find a way to end this war in Syria, which is the greatest terrorist war, I think, in recent human history.
All right. Well, Alexander, getting more news about the missile attack that IRGC has actually used six ballistic missiles in their attack against this terrorist camp inside of Syria. And speaking of IRGC, Alexander, we see that they are number one on Trump's list as far as trying to implement added sanctions against the entity and pressure in every way, and basically trying to show that they're not a reputable organization. It's as if the opposite side is trying to be portrayed, as we see, for example, in the resistance group of Hezbollah from Lebanon, of course, being on a terrorist list. So what does it mean, Alexander, when the entities that have been at the forefront of fighting against terrorism is in the scopes of the United States and many of its Western allies, and yet we see entities that have inflicted such terror in the region still functioning? For example, we see a lot of them gathered right now in Aleppo, Syria, where the United States continue to try to protect them. So what does it all mean?
Well, the answer to your question was in your question. It's being targeted as a number one entity because it's the number one entity that's actually defeating the terrorists. This is very, very important. This is the image that they're trying to tarnish in the minds of the masses in the West, in Europe, and here in the United States, and certainly in our northern neighbor, Canada. The more effective you become in this fight against terrorism, the more they accuse you and the more they want to sanction you because of the fact that you're effective and that you're actually defeating the terrorists. The way they're personally going after General Qasem Soleimani, a man of integrity, a man of honor, a true warrior, a warrior's warrior. I know U.S. Marines personally who praise this man, Some of them are my former students. They come and tell me the stories they've heard from their Iraqi, the people in Iraq. Also, I've had students from who are in illegal bases in Syria who have told me that they look at President General Soleimani as a mythical character. So, of course, they're going to target it. If they didn't target it, we would have to be surprised. They want this war to continue. They want the hemorrhage to go on. We were so close. The terrorists were cornered in Idlib. The estimates were between 10 to 60,000. It's more like 70,000, actually, and they were cornered. And Iran was steadfast. Let's not forget, during the Tehran conference, at the very end of the conference, which I believe Press TV was covering, if I'm correct, the Turkish president was trying to negotiate a safe passage or a ceasefire. And then Iran, of course, didn't agree to that. And then later on, we had Russia and Turkey agree to that. We were baffled by that. This could have ended there. This really, really could have ended there. This was their last stronghold. So we all understand, none of us are naive. Politics does make strange bets. But terrorism is a snake. If you feed a snake, it's going to come back and bite you.
Indeed.
I think, yeah.
Go ahead. And let me just, because more breaking news coming from the IRGC, that after the missile attacks and 7 military drones were used to continue targeting the terrorists' positions. Again, that's the latest information coming from IRGC, that 7 military drones continue targeting the terrorists' position after the missile strike. Now, Alexander, when we look at, again, we look at the situation about terrorism, we know the leader of the Islamic Revolution, Ayatollah Sayyid Ali Khamenei, time and time again, had said, even from the beginning of the Syrian war, and telling Western countries and regional countries not to support these terrorist groups because they will come back to haunt you. And of course, we're seeing attacks taking place in various parts of the world attributed to some of these same terrorist groups. So my question to you is, why would they support entities that they really don't have total control of, and at the end of the day, likely to come back to haunt them?
That's another great question. First of all, one answer to that question is that Washington has had a schizophrenic policy in the Middle East, really, since 2003, invasion and occupation of Iraq under President George W. Bush. It is truly schizophrenic in a geopolitical sense. Secondly, they actually are erroneous in their thinking that they could control these terrorists. The terrorists that they created in Afghanistan during the Soviet war against that country, Al-Qaeda morphed out of that. How can we forget Zbigniew Brzezinski, who was a national security advisor under President Carter, talking in front of this group? The videos are available on the YouTube. He was in the mountains talking to them, calling them freedom fighters, telling them God is on their side. Of course, there were legitimate forces within those groups that were fighting the Soviets. The Northern Front comes in mind, with the Ahmad Shah Massoud, which interestingly was murdered a day before 9/11. But for most part, what we're seeing right now, for example, with ISIS, is that they are having presence in Afghanistan, which is being said, this is the longest war this country has fought, and it doesn't make sense whatsoever to fight the same people you've been fighting in Syria and Iraq, supposedly. That's what they say. Mm-hmm. As you said, it is, they are biting the hand that fed it. But on the same token, they provide safe passage to these groups, not just in Syria, but also getting them into Afghanistan. This is a major, major problem we're going to see effects of this in the months and years to come. And let's not forget, the only areas in Syria that ISIS is operating are the areas that the United States is supposedly covering. So what does that really tell us? It's their terrorists. They are the ones that want to maintain terrorism. And this is the second way to answer your question, is that they want to create mayhem and anarchy and chaos in this region for as long as possible. This region has tremendous human potential. The average age from Morocco to Pakistan is rather low compared to Western countries that have a negative population growth. Secondly, it's very rich in minerals and natural gas and oil. And of course, you know, if the region's main export was broccoli, I don't think they'll be disinterested in creating as much mayhem as possible. So that's another reason.
Well, interesting enough, though, Alexander, when we look at, for example, the terrorist attacks that took place inside of the United States, we look at 9/11, and we have seen that they have pointed the finger, some of the legal entities have pointed the finger at Saudi Arabia being heavily involved in this, and yet we see Riyadh and Washington being not only very good friends, but cooperating a lot in this region. So what does that mean? And what does that mean for the American people who are still seeking justice and trying to get questions answered from what really happened on 9/11/2001?
It's really interesting. I remember this campaign that was started on the internet when the U.S.'s war, this is contrary to how they stated, it's not Syrian civil war. It's the NATO's war, to be perfectly inclusive, NATO's war, and of course some of these corrosive countries in the regions, it was their war in Syria. I remember the campaign that many military personnel, United States military personnel, started. They were holding a piece of paper in front of their face and it said, I refuse to be Al-Qaeda's air force, or I refuse to fight for Al-Qaeda. So there's tremendous amount of awareness and awakening that's literally taking place within the U.S. armed forces. Let's not forget, in 2012, 3 out of 4 people in United States armed forces, as the polls indicated, were supportive of Ron Paul, a libertarian, a true anti-imperialist, anti-war candidate. So that makeup is changing. Also, you mentioned Saudi Arabia. Former Senator Graham of Florida, about two or three years ago, was very vocal about wanting to reveal those 28 pages out of the official 9/11 commission report, which nobody's talking about right now, because after Mr. Trump, of course, this was unprecedented for American president to visit Saudi Arabia, a terrorist supporting nation. His first foreign visit was to Saudi Arabia, where he signed a $315 billion 10-year contract with this country, and then of course Israel. That Israel was no surprise to us, but the way they were trying to alienate Iran, a country that is actually fighting terrorists, a country that is under no illusion. We have heard from Dr. Zarif that Iran is under no illusion that Saudi Arabia should not play a role in this region. They want a consultative Saudi Arabia. They want a Saudi Arabia which would cease and desist from its corrosive policies in the region. Yemen, let's not forget Yemen, around 15,000 people have been killed as a result of Saudi bombing and GCC, 100,000 children in danger of cholera and malnutrition. I mean, they're destroying the next generation there. Yet the Iranian diplomats have been very reconciliatory, contrary to the responses they get from their Saudi counterparts, which at many times has been just rude. I heard from Dr. Zarif that one time when he talked to the Saudi foreign minister, turned around and basically said, this is an Arab matter that is, you should just back out, it's none of your business. This kind of dissing and insults that you're getting. So unfortunately, the more Mr. Trump and now Israel, the more they stand behind this regime in Riyadh, the more they're going to be emboldened to do what they're doing. And certainly since the death of King Abdullah and the advent of King Salman, and for all matters and purposes his son Mohammed bin Salman is in charge, this is not an individual who's balanced or has any experience geopolitically. In his country, we are being told by the media in this country that is popular, I don't think that's the case, I think that's propaganda, but geopolitically he has no understanding, and he has bled the Saudi treasury to the point of them wanting make Saudi Aramco a public company. They have changed position on that, but they've been bankrupting themselves by being on the wrong side of history, and this seems to go on, and they don't seem to learn the lesson. I'm hoping that their defeat, hopefully their ultimate defeat in Syria, if in fact that happens, we are hoping and we are witnessing, would send a strong signal to Riyadh to change its policy now or face a certain doom in the Arab Street. They may get support from London and many NATO countries and United States, but in the Arab Street, they have zero credibility. I know people who personally, who were at this latest Hajj, and they told me that people's behavior was very different toward Iranians compared to, say, 2015, during that horrible rampage that Iran lost hundreds of people. So even in Saudi Arabia, people's image of Iran is changing because they're seeing how Iran is standing up for truth, justice,